So, physical chemistry or chemical physics, what's the difference? Physical chemistry is done in chemistry departments, mostly by chemists, and means that we apply physical methods to chemical problems. Chemical physics is done in physics departments, mostly by physicists, and does basically the same. We use physical methods, experiment, and theory to study chemical phenomena. And the chemical physics group at the Institute for Iron Physics and Applied Physics explores new chemical reaction pathways and reaction mechanisms. In short, we like to play. So, and one playground is to make carbon dioxide form new bonds. Carbon dioxide is known as a linear molecule, three atoms, neutral, and very unreactive. That's what you learn at school. But you know from experience, if you have beer or water in a bottle, and you open the bottle, carbon dioxide comes out. This is dissolved, physically dissolved carbon dioxide, but a small fraction of the carbon dioxide has chemically changed in water and deforms to this bent structure, which you see down. There, it attaches another hydroxide ion, and the presence of the hydroxide ion changes the geometry, the structure of CO2, and makes it react. And another way of making CO2 change its geometry is attaching an electron. And then this changed geometry, it can be part of bigger molecules like acetic acid, which you know from vinegar, or polyethylene terephthalate, in short PET bottles. They are composed of bigger molecules which contain large amounts of carbon dioxide in this bent geometry. So it's a very simple idea. How all we need to do to make carbon dioxide is react is stick an electron to it and study its chemistry. So sticking an electron to carbon dioxide is not that simple, because if you take carbon dioxide in the gas phase and put the electron on, it's a metastable state. This has been observed by many groups, among others by our rector, Tilman Merck, in 1986, published in Kempf's Letters. It has a negative adiabatic electron affinity of minus 0.6 volts, and it has a very short lifetime, the CO2 minus ion, which can be its sufficiently long-lived to be observed in a time-of-flight mass spectrometer, for example, but it's too short-lived to do chemistry with it. So, what do? We study the chemistry of carbon dioxide miners in water clusters, and we use an FTICR mass spectrometer to perform these experiments. So, and first we we have to embed CO2 with the negative charge in water clusters. Water clusters are formed in a supersonic expansion of a helium water mixture into high vacuum. And the neutral water clusters need to pick up charge. Charge is provided by shining a pulsed neodymium laser on a metal surface. We use zinc because zinc has also a negative electron affinity, so we don't get interference with zinc minus ions in our mass spectra. And if we do the timing right, the water clusters with possible seed gases pick up a single electron, then the ions are transferred through an electrostatic lens system into the ultra-high vacuum region of the mass spectrometer. And here we can do chemistry. The base pressure of the ICR cell is around 10 to the minus 10 millibars, means if you store an ion there for 100 seconds, there's only one collision on average over this very long time. And if we purposely introduce a reaction gas to, let's say, 10 to the minus 8 millibars, then we have roughly one collision per second. So if we take mass spectra every, let's say, 0.1 seconds, we can follow the kinetics of the reaction. We can monitor what was in the beginning and how the reactant ions disappear and how the product ions slowly appear, and also secondary and further products on after multiple collisions. So this is very convenient. We can also do a lot of other things with this mass spectrometer, like mass selection at any particular time, user defined by this control software of the instrument. So how does an FTICR work in principle? We need a very high magnetic field, typically in our case 4.7 Tesla, but it goes up by now to 18 Tesla, what is commercially available. Ions in the high magnetic field, the magnetic field is perpendicular to the plane of the image. The ions are forced by the magnetic field on very small cyclotron orbits. They are if the ions are thermalized, they have orbiting radii of about on the order of micrometers. And then we have the ions sitting in the center of the cell. And if we want to mass select or detect the ions, we can resonantly excite the trajectories of the ions by putting a radio frequency field on these excitation plates. Then if the ions are on a relatively high radius, about 70% of the cell radius, we have a coherent ion package which is orbiting with the cyclotron frequency here passing by the detection plates. These ions induce image charges on the detection plates, and these image charges cause a voltage difference between the plates, which is oscillating with the cyclotron frequency. So all we need to do is detect this electric signal as a function of time, do a Fourier transformation, and we get the cyclotron frequency of the ions. And the cyclotron frequency is easily converted to mass spectrum. Because we detect frequency, mass resolution is very high, typically on the order of 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6. That means at mass 100, the third significant digit after the decimal point is still significant, and we can use it to discriminate the elemental composition and determine the elemental composition of the ions. So, our ICR has traveled quite a bit. It was installed originally in Munich, traveled over Berlin and Kiel, now to Innsbruck, where it is waiting for reinstallation. What we see here is an ICR cell, the detection, the excitation plates, one pair, the detection plates, and then the ions are trapped in the along the magnetic field axis by an electrostatic potential. That's the two so-called trapping plates, and that makes a Penning trap, which you know from your lectures. We can also change the temperature of the environment by a liquid nitrogen cooled shield, and this allows us to control temperature from 80 to roughly 350 Kelvin. We also do some theory, very simple quantum chemistry with standard packages on our own. We do RKM modeling, master equation modeling, and then collaboration with theory groups, in particular with Chi Kit Siu in Hong Kong. We have access to more advanced quantum chemistry, advanced post-Hartree Fock methods, and ab initio molecular dynamic simulations. These are usually tasks that need to be done by specialized theoretical chemist or theoretical physicist, and the problems get very quickly very, very complicated. So back to our systems, back to carbon dioxide. We use water clusters because water clusters are a very nice, tractable system to study aqueous chemistry in the gas phase. For example, if we take a water cluster with 55 water molecules, it amounts to a one molar solution. So one ion in 55 water molecules is a one molar concentration, which is perfectly doable and obtainable in a test tube. That means a protonated water cluster has a pH of zero, very acidic. A hydrated hydroxide ion of the same size has a pH of 14, and the system is roughly 1 nanometer in size, so it's justified to call it a nanodroplet. And we can have multiple ions in there, like all we need, what we need for to do mass spectrometry is that we need one net excess charge at least so that overall the particle is charged and can be handled by electrostatic fields. So what we see here, first we have a mass spectrum at 0 seconds. The red line is connecting so-called hydrated electrons. That means a water cluster with one extra electron. This is a species which we can handle very well in our mass spectrometer, but it's very difficult to handle in solution. In solution, these types of studies require accelerators, and there for very short times, these transient species are formed, but then there are always protons present, which can recombine with the electron, form hydrogen, and there's a very complicated arrangement of reactions going on in bulk solution. In our water cluster, nothing else can happen. The electron is sticking there, interacting with water molecules, so there are actually hydrogen bonds connecting to the cloud of the electron, and this the hydrogen bonds, OH bonds, pointing towards the electron form the binding potential well for the electron. So we can use these clusters to do chemistry. We introduce CO2 here in the back in the ICR cell, and we see after 4 seconds the water clusters have taken up to 50% of the water clusters have taken up exactly one carbon dioxide molecule. Only one, not the second one. This is important because it tells us that the CO2 is not physically dissolved in the cluster, but it has to have reacted with the electron. Otherwise, additional CO2 molecules most likely would go in. So we have formed this anionic state of carbon dioxide, and it's no longer metastable. We can observe it for very long time. So these clusters survive for minutes in the ICR cell if we cool it. So that means they are they are stable structures. There's a positive electron affinity of carbon dioxide stabilized by water molecules. We can sum the intensities of all the cluster sizes, which we have seen in the picture before, the very intense one, 50 water molecules each line here, represents one cluster size. And we can sum the intensities over all cluster sizes and and can fit pseudo first order reaction kinetics to, can fit pseudo first order reaction kinetics to the reaction and see it works fine. That means the efficiency of a collision is always the same regardless of cluster size. And we can also calculate the average cluster size as a function of time. We see that the clusters shrink over time, and we see that the clusters containing carbon dioxide are smaller than the hydrated electrons. The shrinking over time has nothing to do with the carbon dioxide. It's induced by room temperature black body radiation. Water is a very efficient infrared absorber. The absorbing modes overlap very well with the Planck distribution, with the Planck spectrum of at room temperature, and that easily explains why these clusters shrink and lose one water molecule after the other. So we can use these two effects. We have the infrared radiation coming in, heating the clusters, that causes the clusters to lose water, and we have the CO2 coming in, recombining with the electron, forming CO2 minus, and this also heats the clusters. Now we would like to disentangle these two effects to learn how many water molecules evaporate when the CO2 comes in, because that tells us something about the energetics of the formation of this radical anion. We know from the work of Bernd von Isendorf in Freiburg that we need 43 kilojoules per mole to evaporate a water molecule. That also tells us that the water clusters behave pretty much like solid ice, because this is very close to the to the evaporation enthalpy of a water molecule from solid ice. We describe the processes of the shrinking of the clusters due to black body radiation and due to the reaction by differential equations. We have here a term that accounts for the black body radiation, which applies only to the reactant cluster distribution. And we have another term, again here, the black body radiation term, and another term that accounts for the number of water molecules evaporating due to the uptake of the CO2. And these two differential equations can be used to fit the average cluster size as a function of time. And that tells us that roughly one water molecule is evaporating when the CO2 is taken up in the cluster. And that tells us that 43 kilojoules per mole are released in this reaction. So we have seen that we can form this potentially reactive state of CO2 in the cluster. Neutral CO2 has an even number of electrons. CO2 minus has an odd number of electrons, and the molecule with an odd number of electrons is a radical. And radicals are potentially reactive, some more, some less. CO2 minus does chemistry. It's not the most aggressive radical, but we can study chemical reactions, formation of covalent bonds. And the prototypical reaction of a radical, which is very important, for example, in polymerization reactions, is addition to a carbon-carbon double bond. And we found that methyl acrylate does the job, so CO2 minus is adding to methyl acrylate. This carboxylation of olefins, so an olefin is organic molecule with a double bond, that's all. We have at least one double bond. We have the CO2 minus radical, and we have two positions where this radical can attach, either in the end or a little bit off the end. Chemists know that the end position is preferred. Physicists like to know why this is, how much the difference it is, the difference in energy, how much preferred is the end position. So we calculated it. It means our friend Chi Kitsiu in Hong Kong calculated it for us, attached the methyl acrylate molecule to CO2 minus, embedded in a very small water cluster. But this cluster is already big enough to form the realistic environment for the CO2 minus. And we see indeed that addition in the end position is 89 kilojoules per mole exothermic, and in the off-center position, chemically speaking, in the beta position, it's only 45 kilojoules per mole. So that's 45 kilojoules per mole is roughly half an electron volt. 89 kilojoules per mole is almost a full electron volt. One electron volt is 96.48 kilojoules per mole. That's a conversion factor which goes into the blood sooner or later. So that's the two product clusters. Theoretically, it's fine. Experimentally, we need to prove that it's actually happening. You can calculate a lot in quantum chemistry, but it's always the crucial point is, does it actually happen? And we can study this easily in the mass spectrometer if we add the CO2 to the cluster source. And we add the methyl acrylate molecule in the back into the ICR cell. And we can do the same experiment as before. We have in the beginning the CO2 minus embedded in the hydration shell. So with 64 water molecules, this is very intense. And after 7 seconds, most of the clusters have reacted. We have taken up exactly one methyl acrylate, and that's the fact that only one molecule is taken up tells us it's not hydrogen bonded in the cluster, because then we would have more molecules coming in. And we can also do the nanocalorimetric analysis, and that shows that we have 2.2 water molecules evaporating. That translates to minus 95 kilojoules per mole. And that fits very well to the theoretical calculation, which said 89 kilojoules per mole. So all over, we can pretty sure this carbon-carbon bond has formed in this system. So much to carbon dioxide. Now the second example, completely different story of our research. We use atomic force microscopes to rip chemical bonds apart. Means we have to attach a single long polymer strand between a surface and an AFM cantilever, AFM for atomic force microscope. And when we start moving down with the piezo, the surface, then the molecule is stretched. And in a force extension curve, we measure the force on the cantilever, that means the deflection of the cantilever, as a function of the position of the surface. And if we move the surface down, is the extension going up, then the force goes up at some point. First, the molecule is loosely coiled, and we have to work only against entropic forces to make it straight. And then in this case, there's a plateau. That means there's some transition, like a chair-boat transition in a sugar, which causes these typical plateaus. And when the molecule is pretty much stretched, then the force goes up really high, because then we have to deform chemical bond angles, and we have to stretch covalent bonds. And that, of course, requires much more energy than these transitions before. And if we pull a lot more, then, of course, at some point, the molecule ruptures. The connection is lost when the molecule gets too long. This is a process which one can call mechanochemistry. This has been studied in the bulk for a long time, and even Staudinger realized that if natural rubber is treated mechanically to make it softer, covalent bonds in the backbones of the big macromolecules are broken. So this is real. It's very relevant, of course. If materials degrade, then also chemical bonds break. And we are interested to study these chemical reactions going on under mechanical force quantitatively at the single molecule level, because in the bulk, it's very hard to define the force acting on a single molecule. In this AFM, we can directly measure it. And that's perfect to develop a coherent theory for mechanochemistry applied to covalent bonds. So in 1999, friends of mine did an experiment covalently anchoring large molecule, a large poly sugar, polyamylose, to a glass surface and to the AFM tip, stretching it and observing these force curves. And they observed ruptures here, micro ruptures of the anchors here, and then the final big rupture when the last anchor is broken. And these ruptures all occur in the nano-Newton range, means relatively high forces in terms of of forces acting in molecules. So nano-Newtons can change and break covalent bonds. Piconewtons are required, 100 piconewtons are required to move, change the structure of molecules. That was very straightforward statistic. We didn't have so many events. We had only on the order of 100 events. And I developed a simple theory to describe these force rupture events. Nowadays, we are doing the experiments in our lab with an asylum research, AFM, which is mounted on an optical microscope. This single molecule force spectroscopy, we study rupture forces. And in order to develop theory, we need a lot of events, because the rupture occurs statistically, and the scatter is very large. And in this experiment, where the cantilever and the surface are moved apart at a constant velocity, the force is increasing with time. And this is the so-called force loading rate. So the velocity with which the cantilever is moved relative to the surface is translated to the force loading rate. And depending on the force loading rate, we get this distribution of rupture forces. And from these rupture force distributions, we, with a simple Arrhenius kinetics model, we can extract the parameters for this for the activation of the covalent bond. If we use a Morse potential to describe the molecule, the bond which is breaking in a one-dimensional chain, then application of force is changing the potential. And I was not the first one to have this idea. Kautzmann and Eyring were drawing pretty much the same figure already in 1940 in Czechs. And in recent year, this paper gets a decent number of citations again, much more than it used to get back in the 1940s. So the force is an additional, causes an additional linear potential. And the Morse potential summed together with the mechanic potential causes this defined activation barrier. We have a transition state here. We can calculate the height of the barrier. And with this, we can calculate, very simple, the off rate of the molecules. And of course, if you hear Arrhenius, you also think about temperature dependence. If we do temperature dependent experiments at here only at three different temperatures, we get three of these scattered plots. And from these distributions with a genetic algorithm fit and maximum likelihood estimation methods, we can extract the Arrhenius parameters for the reaction for the bond breaking. And these parameters don't really fit to the breaking of a covalent bond. These parameters rather indicate that we deal here with a bond hydrolysis. That means a chemical reaction where a proton attaches to to a functional group in the bond, and then in the end a water molecule is split and inserting into the molecule. It's not a brute force rupture, it's a force-induced chemical reaction which we see here. And of course, we would like to study real rupture events of covalent bonds. That means we have to develop the proper protocols to do this in the future. And we are currently working on stronger anchor molecules to really come to the point where we have here rupture dissociation energies that are really applicable to covalent bonds. That would be rather in the 250 kilojoule per mole region, or 2.5 electron volts and up. So in the studies which I've shown so far, we always had the problem to pinpoint which bond is breaking. So we use qualitative arguments. The breaking bond is always the weakest bond, but maybe you can't really define which bond is the weakest bond. In order to be able to tell really which bond is broken, we asked friends from the organic chemistry department to synthesize specifically this big macrocycle, which is containing this triazole moiety. It's an azide coupled to an alkene. And this is the famous click reaction, which forms these five-membered rings. And this five-membered ring attached to these end groups, we can bypass with an aliphatic chain. And this big molecule with the acid ends, we can include or embed covalently in a large polymer chain. So if we now break here this bond, or the two bonds, if we break the five-membered ring here, we can open the triazole ring. And we see we opened this ring because the molecule is increasing its length by a defined value. And this length change is actually measurable. So here's the, in order to, you know, chemists can do fantastic things. Half a year of work, and with these easy steps here all around, we end up having this nice molecule which we ordered. Unfortunately, you cannot order it from Aldridge. You have to find somebody who dedicates half a year of manpower to synthesize 20 milligrams of the substance. So these are very, very tricky tasks which are mastered by people like Uli Lüning from Kiel. So we used the molecule and we did the experiment. We see also the big rupture event in the end, but before the molecule completely rips off the surface, we see this little micro rupture. And here in this rupture, we see a length increase of the molecule, and the length increase matches perfectly the calculated length increase due to the stretched aliphatic chain, which was used in the synthesis to bypass the triazole ring. So with this method, we are able to pick out the events from a large ensemble of experiments. We can pick out the events which are really addressing the bond of interest, and we can specifically use this technique to study particular so-called mechanophores, which are now synthesized by on the order of 10 groups all over the world who are interested in mechanochemistry. They are synthesizing these molecules, they are ripping them apart by sonication, in means with ultrasound, and we want to do this quantitatively and characterize these mechanophores and develop a more predictive theory to bring more physics into this field of mechanochemistry. So with this, I want to switch to the outlook. Of course, thanks to the efforts of our rector, we are in a position to get a new mass spectrometer. It's a newer for us. It will not be completely new, but a very, very recent, very nice instrument equipped with electrospray and MALDI source, which we are going to use to study reactions of real-life catalysts, homogeneous catalysts embedded in large solvent clusters to mimic reactions which are of interest, directly of interest to organometallics. And this instrument can also be used in complex mixture analysis. You're going to see what's coming along when we work with it. So another new addition to our existing setup will be a visible UV visible near-infrared optical parametric oscillator. That means shortly a tunable laser, which we can use to do photochemistry and spectroscopy on the ions in the ICR cell. This will enable us to actually show the chemical connectivity of the reaction products and probe the chemical connectivity and show that we really have in the instrument what we think we have. And with the single molecule force spectroscopy, right now the experiments are very time demanding, but we have ideas to not put only one mechanophore into a long polymer chain, but rather on the order of 1,000 mechanophores and watch the length change as a function of time. And this should follow first order kinetics. So that means we would get, if it works, and we think it's going to work if we do everything right, we are going to get the full kinetics from one single pulling experiment and not as up to now from 1,000 pulling experiments. And that, of course, opens up much more possibilities. We will get much more precise values because we increase our database by a factor of 1,000. So with this, I would like to thank all the people involved in the work and all the people who have helped me in my career. You always need mentors. You always need people who believe in what you are doing. First of all, of course, you need to believe in what you are doing, and you need to think it's worthwhile doing these things. And of course, at some point, you cannot do the experiments, the fun part on your own. You need somebody to do the real job in the lab. That's all the students on the left side from Kiel, from Berlin, and from Munich. And here, all our collaborators over the years. And of course, you need money. Funds came from German Science Foundation, from Forder Chemischen Industrie, DAAD, to finance the exchange with Hong Kong. The Alexander von Humboldt Stiftung sponsored my trip to Berkeley and also visits of people like Ji Kit Siu, who was a postdoc in Munich and now is a professor in Hong Kong. And of course, the biggest part of the finance always comes, but is never mentioned, but the biggest part of the funding comes from the universities, from the federal states, which finance the universities, and they really provide the environment. And I'm very happy to be able now to build up the group here in Innsbruck.